Welcome back to my YouTube channel. I am Riti Kumari and I'm back with another video of the DBMS series. So in this particular video, we would be knowing more about schema and instances. In the last set of videos, we got to know more about abstraction, the level of abstraction. So you would be thinking that why we are knowing these terms in details. So basically, we are moving towards DBMS architecture, and after that also there would be many videos where I would be using this term. So you should be familiar enough with all these terms, and these terms are also important. So without any further delay, let's get started. So firstly, we will start with schema and then we will see what is instance. So schema. A schema is a logical container or a structure that organizes and defines the structure of a database. It identifies how data is organized, what data types are being used, what constraints are applied, the relationships between different pieces of data. A schema acts as a blueprint for the database, ensuring data integrity, consistency, and efficient data retrieval. So let's understand from an example, okay? So in programming terms, we always give like int a. So what does this mean? A is a variable which is stored at a memory location and its data type is int. So we can only store integer type values in a, and a is stored at a particular memory location. Now in a, we can give the value as 2, either we can give the value as 3, either we can give a value as 21. We can give any value which would be integer, but a remains at the same place at the same memory location. So in the same way, what is schema? Schema is basically now a blueprint of the database. So consider I am creating a database of customer. Okay. So for this, what I need to do is first I need to make a customer table. So we will be first making a customer table. Second, I need to give some rows and columns in this particular customer table. Okay. At the third place, what I'll give, that I will give some field names or some column names and provide the data type they can hold. Now, in the fourth number, we will be defining the constraints in that particular DB. So let's see. So basically, consider that this is my customer table. Now, customer table would be having some rows and some columns. So right now, consider it is having 2 rows and 3 columns. Okay. Rows is 2, columns is 3. Now consider that they would be having some column names as well. So consider I am giving this column name as ID, this as customer name, and this as customer address. Okay. Now I have given the rows, I have given the columns, I have given the names to the column. Now I need to provide the data type. So ID would be something which would holding an integer value. Name would be something which would be holding a character value, and address the same character value, and we can provide the size as well for the same, like consider 8 digits, 14. Okay, so I have given the data type and I have given the limit of that particular data type. Now ID is something which would be unique for all the customer, because it is generated at the time of, you can say, at the time of billing, or at the time of we are feeding the entry of customer into our table. So ID is something which is very unique. So we can provide, or we can say this ID is a primary key for my table. So it is a primary key. So basically constraints in DB, all these things we have done in this particular schema. So now in ID, I can like give any value. Either I can give 1, 2, 3, I can give 4, 5, 6, I can give 7, 8, 9. I can give any value which would be of type integer. So basically, I am giving a blueprint of my database here. So schema is a blueprint for the database which ensures data integrity. Like I can't put on any value which is apart from int in this customer ID. Data consistency, that my data remains constant throughout all the databases or throughout all the table. There won't be any duplicacy. and efficient data retrieval. So if I am having ID, I can retrieve the data for any of the customers. Now here we have defined the data types, we have defined the constraints, we have defined the relationship between different pieces of data. So this is called as schema. Now there are various types of schema. So let's understand about that. So types of schema. The first schema is called as physical schema. Are you getting something? In the last set of videos we discussed about physical level in abstraction. So it is kind of similar to physical level of abstraction. So physical schema. In a physical schema, it defines how the data is stored on the underlying hardware, including details such as storage format, file organization, indexing methods, and data placement. So basically in physical schema, now we basically deal with the physical terms like where my data is particularly stored. So in physical schema, I am concerned about where my data is stored on the hardware or disk or any memory space. So consider that my data is stored at this particular memory. Okay. So at this particular memory space, my DB is stored. Now I can like see some of the methods of storing the data in the database. Like I can use the hashing method. I can use the B-tree method. Like there are many methods. There are many indexing methods which we can use, so that when we are querying and when we want the data, there should be a proper optimization which is established. So if I use like the file organization techniques, the indexing techniques, indexing techniques, then I could get my data very easily and very effectively, and it can also help in optimizing the data, and also these methods would help in the storage optimization as well. So in the physical schema, we basically deal about how the data is stored in the hardware or in the disk or in the memory space. Now what are the characteristics of physical schema? So it primarily focuses lies in enhancing the storage and retrieval of data to boost the performance. Again, the same thing which I told in the last slide, that we make sure that we put the data in a proper place, in a proper storage or in a proper memory, so that it can be very easy for us to retrieve that data, and also it could help in the storage optimization, which would eventually lead to boosting of the performance. Now the second one is modification meets to the physical schema demand meticulous planning and can potentially affect the overall performance of the database. So basically consider that my database is at one particular location. Now I am moving that database to another location. Then again, I need to be concerned about how the data is being stored, what all methods of indexing we are using, how the data is being stored, how I can retrieve the data, what is the time it is taking for the data retrieval, what is the storage optimization. So there are many things. So if there are some modification made to the physical schema, it could potentially affect the overall performance of the database, because right now the data is stored in such a way that it gives me the higher performance, it takes lower time and gives the higher performance, but there could be a chances that if the modification is made, it could take more time, which could lead to a lower performance. Now the example: deciding to use clustered index on specific columns for a faster retrieval. As I told that we use some indexing methods. About all these indexing methods we would be knowing in the coming videos, but you just understand in a way that there are many methods. We use some of the methods to like on specific columns for getting the data as fast as possible. Now the second schema is logical schema. A logical schema defines the database structure from a logical or conceptual perspective without considering how the data is physically stored. Now in the physical schema, we were majorly focusing on how the data is stored. Now here we would be focusing more on what data is stored. So I'm not concerned about wherever my data is stored in the memory location. I am mostly concerned about what kind of data is being stored. So logical schema is of two types. First one is conceptual schema and second one is external or view schema. See, all these terms we have already read in the abstraction video, the types of level. So it is kind of similar to that, but still I'm trying a lot to make you understand again that what all these terms basically mean. Now, the types of logical schema. So, the first one is conceptual schema. The conceptual schema represents the overall view of the entire database. It defines the high-level structure and relationships between all the data elements. The example which I told in the schema that we are making a blueprint of all the columns, all the rows. We are giving some data types to these particular columns, like ID can have only integer values, name can have only character values, and like this. So basically, we are defining a database. We are making tables. We are making rows. We are making columns. We are giving the data types. We are identifying the relationship between them, and we are also adding some constraints. Like ID is something which is unique for every customer, so that can be a primary key. Again, for the keys, we will be knowing about it in the next set of videos, but just understand in a way ki something which is unique, something which can't be like something which shouldn't be twice or shouldn't exist twice. So consider that there is a customer ID. So every time whenever you are generating a customer ID, it will be a random thing. So one time a customer ID could be 1, 2, 3. One time it could be 4, 5, 6, it could be 7, 8, 9, but again it couldn't be 1, 2, 3. So there won't be any case where customer ID which is generated for every person, consider it is generated for A, it is generated for B, it is generated for C. For D also, the customer ID remains the same, which is of A. It won't be possible. So there are some constraints, there are some columns, there are some rows which we define for a particular schema. It would be a better word to call. So for a particular schema, we define everything. So in conceptual schema, it basically depends on that what are the relationships we are giving for that particular schema, what is the number of rows, what is the number of columns, what is the data types. Now the second one is external or view schema. An external schema defines the user specific views of the database. It focuses on the portion of database data relevant to specific user, roles or application. So consider that there is a database of customer. Okay. Let's take an example of an e-commerce website. So in e-commerce website, there would be many tables. One table would be of customer. Second table would be of orders the customer had made. Third table would be the prices for all the things and then discount and everything. So there would be three tables present. Like there would be many tables, but I am just taking an example of three tables. So consider I am a person who is working in the sales team of this e-commerce website. So if I'm working in the sales team, I would be mostly concerned about na ki what all prices customer has paid, what all what is the total amount the customer has paid, what was the total discount it got, how the sales are increasing, and much more things. So I would be mostly concerned about some specific table. If I am someone who is like seeing the analysis, like what all things customer buys and how I should recommend the customer to buy the same thing, I would see the orders table. So basically, according to the users, na we show different tables or we show different views. So in this view schema, what we do is there are different views, and according to the user specifications, like I want to see the sales, I want to see the data related to customer, I want to see the data related to what all orders customer place, and different things. So in this way, there are different views, and these are user specifications on which the views are shown. So in this schema, basically it defines the user specific views of the database. So basically here it is a customer, here it is an order, and here it is a price table. Okay, so there are some characteristics as well of logical schema. So it delineates how data is structured into tables, the interconnection between these tables, and the restriction placed on data. Again, the same thing, that the data could be only of type integer, what all relationships are between the tables, and what are the number of rows, number of columns, and much more things. So basically it delineates how the data is structured into the table. Now, second point is logical schema prioritize data modeling and database decide over considerations related to hardware or storage specifications. Again, we don't need to be much more aware about like how the storage, where the data is being stored or something like that. I'm not concerned about that. I'm basically concerned about like how my database is being designed, how the how much tables are there, how much rows are there. I'm mostly concerned about what data is stored. I'm not concerned about how my data is being stored in the memory space. Example, defining tables, specifying primary and foreign keys, creating views for the data access. So these are the examples for logical schema. Now the last term in this video is instance. So what is an instance? The information residing within a database at a specific point in time is referred to as database instance. So consider that today I made a database. Okay. It is a customer database. So right now I am having three customers, customer one, customer two, customer three. Okay. So I am having a database of customer one, like how many orders the customer has made, consider that this customer has made, just give me a second, let me make a bigger table for you. Okay, so this is a customer table. ID, number of orders, and I can give the address. Okay. So ID is 1, number of orders is 2, address is Delhi. ID is 2, number of orders remains 5, and ID is address is Bangalore. Okay. So there is one customer which is having an ID 1, the number of orders they have made, total orders is 2, and they reside in Delhi. The ID is 2, the number of orders they have made is 5, and the address where they reside is Bangalore. Now there could be a possibility na ki right now I am living in Delhi, but what if I switch to some other place or some other state like Karnataka? So right now I am working in Delhi, but I have changed my job and right now I am going to Karnataka. So I am relocating to Karnataka. So I would request the website like, matlab, we can take an example of Swiggy. So right now I am in Jharkhand. That is my hometown. I am making orders on Swiggy. I am giving my address. Now I am switched to like I have came to Bangalore. Now I want the order delivered to be delivered at my Bangalore's address, right? So I'll make some update ki okay, right now that was my home address, but now the home address is the Bangalore one. So there would be some update in the database regularly, right? So at an instance, consider at this particular time, this is the data which is stored in the database. There would be some modification made in coming days. So the information residing within a database at a specific point of time is referred to as database instance. So basically the data which is there in my database at the specific point of time is called as instance. Within a given database schema, the declaration of variables within it tables pertain to that specific database. The term instance in the context denotes the current values of the variable at a particular moment in time for the database. So at an instance, the value of address is Delhi, but ho sakta hai after 2 days the address is changed to Bangalore. So at a particular instance, the address is Delhi, but after 2 days, if that particular specific time, if we see, the address could be Bangalore. So in this context, it denotes the current values of the variable at a particular moment in time for that particular database. So schema is basically a physical representation of database or a blueprint of database. Instance is the value of database at that particular specific point of time. So these two terms are kind of very much important because in the next set of videos, again, I'm saying I'll be using these terms. So please watch this video before moving towards the next set of videos. So this was all about this video. Till then, take care, keep learning, keep growing. And also if you're liking my videos, please hit the subscribe button. Bye all.